All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is the last lesson that we're going to have in this unit. We're still in Unit 3 of these land-based empires. We've already gone over Europe. We've already gone over the gunpowder empires like the Ottoman, the Safavids, and the Mughal dynasty. We even went over what was going on in China with the Ming and the Qing. But today we're going to talk about two separate societies, Russia and Japan. It seems odd that I'd be talking about Russia and Japan in the same exact unit or in the same exact lesson, but it will become evident as to why I am putting them together. I want you to be able to compare and contrast them to one another. And that will become obvious as to why I'm doing that by the end of this lesson here. Let's jump into our essential questions. Our essential questions, as usual, are how did land empires expand? We've already seen gunpowder, so that's going to be a common theme, but there's others as well. What methods did land-based empires use to centralize their rule? Think back to the Conrad de Mars model in Unit 1. What were those methods? They're fairly similar in Unit 3. And number 3, how was religion used to unite? And how was it used to divide? By the end of this, you should be able to take two different primary sources and compare Russia and Japan to one another. Let's go ahead and get started here. Let's talk about what's going on in Japan. Japan was underneath this very feudal society. This was something that was very similar to what was going on in Europe. So in Unit 1. So in Unit 1, we saw that Europeans were underneath feudalism, where lords could challenge the power of the kings. Well, that's what's going on in Japan as well. The emperor is just a figurehead, so forget about him. Throw him out of there. We don't need him. At least not yet. We won't need him until a little bit later, as in units from now, like Unit 6. The shogun is more of the king here in the Japanese feudalism, and the daimyos are the lords, the samurai are the knights, and the peasants are the serfs. So most people are peasants, just like in feudalism in Europe, but these daimyos consistently use samurai in order to try to challenge the power of the shogun and try to challenge the power of other daimyos. It's very, very decentralized, and there's a lot of infighting that goes on. One big part that we need to realize here, because it's going to be important in Unit 7, is that there's this idea of Bushido. Bushido is the way of the warrior, more in the sense that it is more honorable to die fighting than it is to surrender and survive. That's going to be a very important mindset when we get to Unit 7, and I'll bring up Bushido once again. This idea of Bushido comes from this particular time period, 1450 to 1750, because the samurai are the ones who are doing the fighting and using that code of Bushido, in the same way that the knights of Europe had a code of chivalry. As I've said, it was highly decentralized, just like European feudalism. Let's go ahead and move on. We're going to get a big change here with the emergence of the Tokugawa shogunate. So first we get people who are fighting against one another. Oda Nobunaga, close, maybe I got it right. He's a daimyo, and he's actually armed with muskets, with guns and gunpowder. That's kind of a common theme in this unit here. But he gets that from the Portuguese. Remember, the Portuguese at this point are trading. And we actually haven't gone over the Portuguese trading quite yet. But the Portuguese have made their way all the way over to Japan, and they are trading with the Japanese, including guns, which the daimyo are more than willing to purchase because they need them in order to fight other daimyo and fight against the shogun. Now, he eventually took over much area in Japan, but was forced to commit suicide in 1582, allowing for his general, Toyotomi Hideyoshi, a lot of tough names in this unit, to step up and start to try to restrict the samurai as well. He is killed in 1598, leaving a 5-year-old heir. This means there's a power vacuum. And when I say there's a power vacuum, I mean there is no one in power. And whenever you have a power vacuum, someone is going to step up and take power. That's this guy right here, Tokugawa Ieyasu. And that's the name that we really need to get from this slide. These two names are important if we were studying just Japanese history, but we're not. We're in AP World History. So Ieyasu is the most important one. He reorganizes the government, the Bakufu, and he centralizes his power. What he does is, and we're going to look at his edicts in class, we're going to look at his rules, and we're going to discuss how he centralized power. But what he's going to do is he's going to limit the power of the daimyo by holding them hostage in Edo, which is modern day Tokyo. Edo is where Ieyasu lives. And he says, hey, daimyo, all you lords, you need to live in this city as well. And all the other daimyos, understanding that Ieyasu has a whole lot of power, are going to come to live in Edo. That way, Ieyasu can keep an eye on them. There's that old saying that you should keep your friends close, but your enemies closer. And Tokugawa Ieyasu understands that. He wants to keep his enemies close so he can keep an eye on them. He's also going to limit the amount of samurai that they can have, and he's going to put in a lot of other rules to take power away from the lords and centralize his rule. That's really, really similar to what occurred in Europe. Think about what was occurring in Europe before. There was feudalism. Then you had people like Isabella and Ferdinand use gunpowder in order to take power away from the lords and centralize their rule. Very similar to what's going on in Japan. Now, Japan, after all of this, and this is under, once again, Tokugawa Ieyasu, they realize that they have been corrupted by European trade. After all, it was European trade that's brought in Christianity, which has destroyed kind of this traditional Japanese culture. It was European trade that brought in these muskets and these guns and gunpowder that made the war so awful and so terrible. So what Tokugawa Ieyasu decides to do is limit the trade. And when I say limit, I mean he's cutting off everyone from trade except for the Dutch. The Dutch give a benefit to the Japanese with their trade, so they're allowed to trade, but they are still limited. They are allowed to trade in one port, and that's really about it. So trade and culture and everything else in Japan is cut off from the rest of the world. This is kind of similar to what China's doing at the same time. Remember, we saw Zheng He, and we saw how his voyages were canceled because the Ming Dynasty wanted to prevent outside foreigners from coming in and influencing that traditional culture. Japan is doing the same thing. So their response to the Western world, their response to Europe, is to move away from Europe. Japan's literally an island or a series of islands, so it's fairly easy for them to cut themselves off from the rest of the world. This is why we're not going to talk about Japan until 1868, until well down the road in Unit 6. So we'll get back to Japan eventually, but we're not going to be talking about them too much in Unit 4 and Unit 5 because they've cut themselves off from the rest of the world. Let's go ahead and move on here. Now, there are some economic changes here. Now, political unification is going to lead to economic growth. And so there is a bit of economic growth. But as we're going to see in Unit 6, Japan is not going to grow as quickly as Europe is in Unit 5. And we'll talk about that more when we get to the Industrial Revolution. But when we look at the Industrial Revolution of Unit 5, we're going to see economic growth in Europe and the technology in Europe just advanced so quickly. And Japan is really going to be at a standstill. Let's go ahead and move on to Russia. Russia's society was actually fairly similar to a European society under feudalism. The serfs are bound to the land by the nobles, and they represent 90% of the population. The nobles in this case are called the boyars. They're just like the nobles in Europe and just like the daimyo in Japan. They want to challenge the emperor, or the czar in this case, for power. They're constantly challenging, trying to get more land, trying to get more serfs, trying to get more money and more power. So that seems to be a pretty common theme. We've seen in Europe that the lords were eventually kind of defeated and power was centralized. We saw in Japan that the daimyo, or the lords, were defeated and power was centralized. So you can take a wild guess as to what you think is going to happen in Russia. Ivan III, or Ivan the Great, is going to step in and he's going to start to centralize his rule using a few different methods. First thing, he's not going to pay tribute to the Mongols. We saw that all the way back in Unit 2 when we looked at the reading by George Vernadsky. And he was talking about how the Mongols had an impact on Russia and how the Mongols and the Golden Horde were getting tribute payment from the Russians. Ivan III says, yeah, we're not doing that anymore. And he's able to do so and able to be very successful at not paying tribute to the Mongols. He's also going to marry the niece of the last Byzantine emperor. I know we didn't talk about the Byzantines much in this class, just because of the way the class is structured, but they were the center of the Eastern Orthodox Church. So by Ivan III marrying a Byzantine emperor's niece, he solidifies himself with the Eastern Orthodox Church. So now he is both the temporal ruler, the Tsar, and he's also the spiritual ruler of the Eastern Orthodox Church. This is a way that he identifies with the people. And we should be familiar with emperors centralizing their power by using religion to identify with the people. He also rebuilt the walls of the Kremlin to show his power. We should be really familiar with how people use architecture in order to centralize their rule, because I brought that up in literally every single lesson in this unit here. This is the Kremlin today. As you can see, this would inspire awe. I mean, this is a massive building here. There's a whole lot of color to it as well. So once again, architecture used to centralize rule. Then we get Ivan the Terrible, Ivan the Fourth. I'll talk about why he's the Terrible a little bit later. He is going to rule from 1547 to 1584. Now he's going to use gunpowder to expand his empire, which should be a shock to no one. He's also going to use a warrior class, kind of similar to the Janissaries. And this warrior class is called the Cossacks. These are these fierce peasants, especially in the western part of Russia, who Ivan the Terrible can work with in order to take over more land. Now, the Cossacks are always going to challenge the rule of the Tsar. That's just the way the Cossacks are. So at times, the Cossacks get to act a bit independent. But when it makes sense for the Cossacks to work with the Tsar, as in like there's a benefit for them if they work with the Tsar, they'll work with the Tsar. Otherwise, the Tsar is kind of there to sort of control them and just keep an eye on them a little bit. So know that. I'll talk about the Cossacks later. The Cossacks, yes, are technically under Russian control, but they often get to do their own thing because they are so strong. Kind of how the Janissaries were as well, where if the Janissaries really wanted to, they could rise up against their own leaders because they were very strong. They had many people. They had all the weapons as well. So, but understand that Ivan IV was using a warrior class of Cossacks in order to centralize and expand his rule. He's going to force the boyars to move to the capital city of Moscow, which should sound really familiar because Tokugawa Ieyasu quite literally did the same thing with all the daimyo. He's also going to institute the secret police in order to prevent any sort of dissent against him. And then he built St. Basil's Cathedral. Once again, an example of architecture and an example of using religion in order to legitimize their rule, all of which should sound familiar. Everything on this slide, I've literally said nothing new, because these are all the same methods that every single ruler has used in the entirety of this unit. So one of those big examples of historical reasoning is comparison. You should be able to compare all of these societies to one another, especially in this unit. There's a lot of comparisons to be made. Now, why is this guy terrible? Why is he Ivan the Terrible? After all, he expands Russia. He seems like a great guy. First of all, look at the guy. If you saw this guy walking down the street, you would go find another street to walk down, because he doesn't look like someone you want to mess with. But in addition to that, he believed, Ivan the Terrible is a little crazy. There's something wrong with his head. But he believes that the boyars actually murdered his first wife in 1560. And so in order to get revenge, he started a reign of terror against these noble boyars and killed and destroyed many of their families. There's also a very infamous story about him that one time he got so mad at his own son that he accidentally killed him. So yeah, there's reasons why Ivan the Terrible is called the Terrible. But one of the big, very similar to Selim, actually, if you think about the Ottoman Empire. If you think about the Ottoman Empire, Selim the Grim was called Selim the Grim because he killed his own half-brothers and he killed his own father. But he also expanded the Ottoman Empire, making it huge and powerful. That's kind of what Ivan the Fourth did as well. Yes, he's terrible, but he did so many good things for Russia to make it very powerful, kind of like Genghis Khan as well, if we can draw some more comparisons there. Let's go ahead and move on. Now, one Russian who isn't really that terrible, and in fact is great, is Peter the Great. And this is the most famous Russian Tsar. I mean, this is the one that everyone knows, with exception of Tsar Nicholas II, who is more infamous as opposed to famous. But we'll talk about him in Unit 7. Now, Peter the Great is part of the Romanov dynasty, and he will rule from a long time, from 1682 all the way until 1725. What makes Peter the Great great is that he's going to work with Europe. At this point, and especially if you look on a map or a globe, you see that Russia extends all the way from the eastern border of Europe all the way over to China. Now, Russia has a choice it can make. Does it want to become more like the Chinese and more like this Eastern ideology? Or does it want to become more like the West and have this Western ideology? Russia is going to always be caught between the two. And we'll see examples of Eastern ideology and Western ideology in Russia, especially once we get to Unit 5 and we get to Unit 7. But at this time, Peter the Great starts to move closer to Europe. He starts to go to Europe and try to copy what they're doing. In fact, in a funny story, Peter the Great actually travels around Europe in disguise, incognito, because he doesn't want people to see him while he's learning about how Europeans run things. This is very odd because Peter the Great is 6'9", and this was all the way back in the 1700s. So he really, really stood out. There was no way for him to hide. It's just like Shaquille O'Neal walking into my classroom with a fake mustache and telling me he's not Shaquille O'Neal. It's like, Shaq, we know it's you, man. Like everyone, there's only one guy who looks like you who's 7'1" and has played basketball before and all of that. So that's just a funny, humorous story about Peter the Great there. But he does go to Europe and he starts to copy what he sees there. He's copying the navy that he sees. He sees that all these European powers have a big navy. So he says, I got a big navy as well. He's starting to see industrialization. And we'll talk about that more in Unit 5. But he says, if Europe's doing industrialization stuff, I need to industrialize as well. And so he starts to bring a sort of enlightenment to Russia, in which Russia starts to become a bit more like Europe. And this is actually seen in the culture. Look at Ivan the Great, big giant beard. Look at Ivan the Terrible, big giant beard. Those were Russian things. Peter the Great doesn't have a beard. Why? Because when he toured Europe, no one else had a beard. He actually, and we'll see this in class, he actually tells the people of Russia, especially the upper class, you have to shave. You're no longer allowed to have a beard. Everyone has to be clean shaven. That's how the Europeans do it. That's how we're going to do it. We even see that the language of the upper class of Russia, the lords, the boyars, and the czar become French. Why are they speaking French? Because France was a dominant European power, and the Russians wanted to be a dominant power as well. So they're just going to copy Europe as much as they can. He also incorporated the Eastern Orthodox Church into his own government and used divine right theory, which is a very European thing to do. Another great czar was Catherine the Great. Now, Catherine the Great, first of all, she's a female leader, so we should know her name, because whenever we have questions about female leaders, we want to be able to bring up Catherine the Great. She's very similar to Isabella of Spain. Now, she'll rule from 1762 to 1796, and she will marry Peter III. It's a very, very unhappy marriage. Peter III, he's a rich kid. He was born a rich kid, he's used to being wealthy, used to not working very hard. And so he kind of acts like this man child because he's never really been forced to grow up. Catherine marries him not because he's such a great guy, marries him because there's power associated with Peter III. It leads to an unhappy marriage. Both of them have many, many affairs. Eventually, she uses her intellect and her power to overthrow him and take control in 1762. Now, why is she the great? She's going to expand Russia to the west, and she's actually going to expand into the Ottoman Empire. The Ottoman Empire and Russia will be fighting against one another for a long time. I mean, they're just common enemies. They're always against one another, something that will be brought up when we're in Unit 7 and talking about World War I. The reason they're against one another is they both want control of the Black Sea and the Bosporus Strait. And I'll try to show you a map in class, but if you have control of the Black Sea and the Bosporus Strait where Istanbul is, then you have a warm water port. And if you have a warm water port, you can trade. And if you can trade, you can produce a lot of wealth. Remember, Russia's to the north. Geographically speaking, they don't have warm water ports to trade in because it's really cold there. So if they can take land from the Ottoman Empire, they can get more ports on more seas and trade and make more wealth. That's what the Russo-Turkish War is all about. And that's a really quick way to describe that war there. But we're not in AP Euro, so we don't actually have to know it in detail. We're just in AP World, so we can just kind of know generally what's going on. The Russians are able to win that war and actually do get a port on the Black Sea, which is great for Russia because that brings in more trade and more wealth. She's going to continue to have her eyes look to the West and continue to copy European rule. As you can see, she very much looks like a European ruler. I mean, look at the way she's dressed. She looks like she's European. So we're seeing Russia more copy the West more and more. And at this point, alarm bells should be going off in your head. You should be thinking, this is why Mr. Cernak put Russia and Japan together, because of their response to the West. You need to be able to contrast them. You see how Japan responded to the West by cutting itself off. You see how Russia responded to the West by starting to westernize and copy what they saw in Europe. We should be able to contrast those things, and we should be able to see the long-term changes because of those decisions in both Russia and Japan. Ladies and gentlemen, that's going to go ahead and wrap up our study of both Russia and Japan. Make sure you have your notes there as well. Make sure you bring them to class, because we're going to use those notes to look at primary sources from both of those societies we just looked at today.